Wow, that's the first. I could say good morning without yelling at you. I mean, yelling good morning, not yelling at you. That's nice, thank you. It's so good to see you all. Look at all these people in here. This is wonderful. Do you know, I just happened to look in the bulletin at the title of the pastor's sermon, The Making of a Great Church. You know what the making of a great church is? You people right here. This is a great church. And why? Because we love the Lord Jesus.
Amen.
We love what he's done for us. We love how he cares for us. And we love each other. We are one in the bond of love, aren't we? It's so good to know that and to feel that. It's great, great. Let me get to the announcements. If we have any visitors today, there's a tear-off sheet that you can fill out and just drop in the offering plate. That's all we want. You just a little information so we know that you were here. Okay. Let's see what's happening today. We have a church council meeting at 4 p.m. Those of you who are involved in that know who you are. So we're going to meet in the social hall at 4 p.m. Tomorrow, the church office will be closed in honor of Memorial Day.
Yay! Yay!
Does that mean I don't have to come to work? I rarely show up on Mondays, do I?
Okay.
Well, that's great. May 30th, that's this Tuesday, is the last kid zone for the school year. I have to say. You know, you guys remind me of when I was a teacher. You know, the kids would start counting down when it reached June 1st and counting down the days. I started in February. But anyway, Kids Zone has been wonderful. So Stacy has been doing, and the team has been doing wonderful work with the children. And I know Stacy would like to say something to us today.
I think I got my mic on, so. Yes, we started this in August with two kids. And we kept thinking, what is going to happen? Are we going to have any more, or is it just going to be two? And after our fall festival in the parking lot, we wound up with two more kids. And if everybody showed up now, what we had this year, we would have 17. So it has been amazing. They have been fantastic. And things changed after spring break. The energy came in because they knew it was the end. So we are a little tireder. Mr. Randy, right? A little bit tireder, but we are going to celebrate tomorrow night with a year-end party. And for those that helped me in Kids Zone, I wish you would stand up right now so the church can give you a round of applause, because y'all are what makes a difference in the kids, in the lives of these kids. So maybe just you, but I love my kids. We have a great team, and it is an honor to be here to be able to serve with them. Tomorrow night, y'all keep praying. We're gonna have a lot of fun tomorrow night.
Yeah, thank you. June 1st, that's this Thursday, correct? Baptist Men's Potluck Supper.
Yeah!
I'm out of here. Okay, so a great church is loving the Lord, loving each other, and being very enthusiastic. That's great. All right, where was I? The Men's Potluck Supper. This Thursday, between 6 and 8 upstairs.
Fried chicken?
If you bring it, we will eat it. Reminds me of a movie. Okay. June 8th, a week from Thursday, we're having game night, 6 p.m. And then finally, I'd like you to read the last announcement there. June 16th, Splash. Do you have a bulletin? I want to make sure you read your bulletin. Oh, I see. You're reading it up here. Murder on the Orient Express. That's a great Agatha Christie play or book. That should be great. So if you're a member of Splash, just circle that date and make it a point to go. It sounds like it'd be a lot of fun. Yes, John?
It's $11 not $9.
I'm sorry?
It's $11, not $9.
Are you thinking of it?
Yeah. Okay.
Wait, I forgot to
say. If you already signed up, it's 9. Now it's going to be 11. So you better hurry up because I heard it may go up to 13. So, well, all righty, our music today is about what does make a great church, and that is about all of us here. So let's stand and sing together.
Colossians 3:12. As God's chosen people, holy and dearly loved, clothe yourselves with compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience. And over all these virtues, put on love, which binds them all together in perfect unity.
Had a great new members class today.
I asked them what time it was at the close, and they said it was 5 till 11. So I kept them a little long, but they were very patient and kind. Does anyone here today have a prayer request that you would like us to pray with you about today?
I pray that we would just love God more.
That we would love God more. That is a great prayer request. Anybody got something on your heart you want your church family to pray with you about?
Pray for our nation.
For our nation and for the world. Yes. Anyone else?
Pray for my daughter.
We'll pray for your daughter, yes. Someone in the choir?
My son Clifton.
Your son Clifton. Anyone else? You know, let me share my heart with you. I know we have an order of service, and we as Baptists love to know everything that's going on. That's just where we are. But the most important thing today here is that we meet with Jesus. Amen. And it would be such a shame for someone to come today with a need on your heart among friends and family who love Jesus and love you, and for you to leave with the same burden you came with. So, give you one more chance. Anybody got another prayer request?
My brother Sam.
Your brother Sam. I would ask you to... Miss Marge.
We're heading out to Rome for 3 weeks, and I would just ask that God would give us opportunity to share with our family. There would be a lot of unsafe family. We'll be spending time with it, and that there would be opportunities for us to share our faith.
That is an awesome prayer request.
I'd like to pray for those people in Guam who've been hit by the typhoon. We've got missionaries over there, and also I've got family over there that are without water, that are without electricity. And they're struggling a little bit in terms of medical services. We've got a great grandson there that needs to go to the ER, but not even sure the ER has electricity.
We sure will. Thank you for bringing that to our attention. Anyone else? I would ask you to continue to pray for our family. Pray for Cricket. That's our daughter. And I know you will. Man, Jesus loves us. Would you grab the hand of someone right next to you as we pray together? Father, thank you for the opportunity we have to be here, to bring our petitions before you, knowing that you listen, that you're attentive to your children. And God, today, as your family is gathered all over the world, you are attentive. Lord, many things that we voice, most of them are well beyond our control, Lord. Safety as we travel, the courage to speak to our family about you, lovingly share Jesus. Lord, we pray that you would empower that witness, and Lord, that it would bring much fruit over the next 3 weeks. Lord, we pray for children that we love who are hurting. We pray for people who are in distress, Lord, Christian missionaries, family members who are hurting because of a typhoon, Lord. And there are so many people in this place who have things on their heart, Lord, that they just couldn't voice publicly. But, Lord, we bear them up to you right now. We pray for our daughters. We pray for our children, our grandchildren, our brothers and sisters. Lord, we pray for this service, God. We ask you to come to us by the person of the Holy Spirit and to tabernacle. Lord, come and dwell among us. We are your people, or the sheep of your pasture. And Lord, you do not dwell in buildings anymore. You dwell in the hearts of your children. So Lord, we pray that you would be the audience today and that your spirit would reside in this place as we sing and worship. God, you're good, and we worship you and we acknowledge you and we thank you that you're faithful and true. Jesus, that you are the conqueror of death, hell, and the grave, and the Savior of our souls, and that eternally we're secure because you live. And Spirit, that you have indwelt us, and you make Christ real in us and in this place. And Father, we pray that today, by the power of your Spirit, we would experience the resurrected Christ. And we ask this prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. I'm going to introduce a church member to you. He's a retired serviceman, and I asked him to come and share a little bit about Memorial Day. Thank God that we're free. Some people don't think you should say that in a church, but I want to tell you, thank God that I'm free spiritually because of the death, burial, and resurrection of Christ, and I'm free as an American citizen because of the sacrifice of men and women who have given me this freedom. And I've asked Brother Ed DeVos to come and just share with us just a little bit.
Easter, a few weeks ago, we had the song was called We Will Remember. Memorial Day is like that. We will remember. Many times we think in terms of Memorial Day of the various conflicts we've had in our country, we think of the, which goes back over 200 years. If we were in a graveyard today of all those people, some of those tombstones would be worn away because of they fought over 250 years ago for you and I. So if we were to enter that graveyard today, some of those graves would be very new because people are still serving you. When you think about people that you see in uniform, you go to Augusta Mall and you see a soldier or airman or in uniform, there's a tendency sometimes to see that person and say, thank you for your service, and just keep on over. What I recommend that you do is you stop for a minute and think that that individual volunteered to serve you. His family volunteered to serve you, to protect you. And so when you see someone in a uniform, I would recommend that you just stop for a minute. Just, sir, I see your uniform. What do you do in the service? Where are you stationed? What have you done? Have a dialogue. Doesn't have to be long. But just to help them understand that you understand who they are and what they did. And so that's really my one point that I would leave you with today is when you see someone in uniform, thank them for what they're doing. We think in terms of the world day for people to die in combat. And certainly that's the main purpose of it. But think about 2 months ago, there were two helicopters, Fort Campbell, Kentucky, night mission, night training, kind of flying in formation, lights out. Something, somewhere, something happened. This guy maybe turned like this, or this guy maybe turned like this. We don't know. We'll never know. But those two Blackhawks crashed. Everybody on board killed. Nine people. Ages from 23 to 32. They died for you. Because we practice, and before we go to combat, to do those things we must do in combat. And so that's why it's important to think about those as well. So I'd ask some people to stand up for just a moment, and please remain standing just to give you a feel for how our congregation is involved. If you're a veteran, please stand and remain standing. If you're a family member who has someone in the service or was in the service, son, daughter, father, please stand. Served our country and are still serving our country. And so for the families, thank you for your service. Because the service member can't do what he does without the support of the family. So thank you for this day. And as I say, we will remember. Thank you.
At this time, Ms. Stacy's going to come and get children.
Y'all walked around and seen these people around here, but a lot of people are wearing some three major colors today. Do you know, have you noticed anything special about them? They kind of like the colors that are up here. What are the colors here?
Red, blue, white.
Red, white, and blue. Well, we're, that's yours, but yes. Red, white, and blue is our colors we're focusing on. So, but sometimes I need that green to be camouflage. Yes, they do. Green is an important color, so. But today, it's Memorial Day, and I don't know if you've seen people, people like to decorate and put out the red, white, and blue, because we're remembering the people, like Mr. Ed said, that they served us. They gave their life for us. Did y'all know that? We have people that serve so that we could be free, that we could be free to come to church today to be able to worship, that we could be free to make our own decisions to go to college and be something. Nobody has to tell us. We got freedom. And we have men and women that died for that freedom so we could be there. And today we want to remember these people. This flag came on a casket that somebody's father passed away, and this is to remember him. So she's got this in her house so she can look at it and see and remember her dad and what he did for her so she could live in a place that's free. But not only do we want to remember the men and women that died for us, there's one more person that's very important, and every single day we should remember him. Yes, he died for me and you, Blair. What's his name?
Jesus.
Absolutely. So today we want to thank Jesus for dying for us so that we could have eternal life with him. So we're thankful for Jesus Christ, right? And we're also thankful for the men and women that gave their lives, whether on the battlefield or, Mr. Ed said, just in their training, everyday training. They served for us, and we thank them for that. Let's pray. God, we just thank you so much that for men and women that said, yes, I want to serve. I want to serve the people. God, thank you for them. Lord, be with their families today, those that have lost loved ones. Comfort them and help them remember the good times and the good things that happened. But God, today, most of all, we thank you for Jesus Christ, for coming, for dying for us, each one of us, so that when we accept him, we can have eternal life with you. God, thank you for loving us. Lord, just be with us as we listen to the message today. Lord, may these words be applied to our lives so that we can go and serve the community. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Amen.
Sin. You were buried for 3 days.
Thank you.
Let's pray. Father, we just thank you for this day and the opportunity to come into your house. As today we want to remember all those who have given the ultimate sacrifice to be able to provide us the opportunity to be able to worship you free and clear. But we certainly couldn't forget the fact that, Lord, you sent your Son to die for us. You've blessed us so much, and that we just like to take this time in our service to be able to return a portion of the bounty that you've given to us and return it for your work here. These things we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, I had a short talk to give you before we started, but I think everything's been said so far, so just let me summarize a little bit here. We are this weekend remembering those who gave the ultimate sacrifice for us, but we also have to remember that we have the opportunity now to worship the one who gave us life forever. I'm not sure that in my lifetime we've been any more divided as a country than we are today. But that doesn't mean that Christians have to be divided. So, anyway, depending upon how we do this, we should always remain undivided. I'm also going to ask you to join me at the end.
Jesus is the heart.
see how many moviegoers we have here. The last hymn that we sung, I told Dave I had never heard it. I have. It was actually in a major movie production.
Titanic.
Well, I'll be. It was sung in Titanic when they were in the service. That's just a little movie trivia for you all. Acts chapter 4, beginning in verse 32. I invite you to Acts chapter 4, beginning in verse 32, and you have to listen very fast because it's already 20 till 12. The full number of those who believed were of one heart and soul. And no one said that any of the things that belonged to him were his own, but they had everything in common. And with great power, the apostles were giving their testimony to the resurrection of the Lord Jesus. And great grace was upon them all. There was not a needy person among them, for as many as were owners of land or houses sold them and brought the proceeds of what was sold, and laid it at the feet of the apostles. And it was distributed to each as any had need. Thus Joseph, who was also called by the apostles Barnabas, which means son of encouragement, a Levite, a native of Cyprus, sold a field that belonged to him and brought the money and laid it at the feet of the apostles. May the Lord add his blessing to the reading of his word. What makes a great church? I titled this The Making of a Great Church? I wonder what you would say a great church is. It's an honest question, especially in the multicultural environment that we live in here in America today. How do we know what a great church is? Is there such a thing as a great church? What would it look like if you thought you were a part of a great church? Where do we begin to find the answers? I would say to you that most pastors, especially of the younger persuasion, and I can pick on us because I am one, would... Amen. Man, I got more amens on that than ever. Most younger pastors would think that if they want to find out what a great church is, they need to go to the latest church growth conference. In fact, books and literature are sold monthly, yearly, on how to grow a great church. But today, I believe that we can find what a great church looks like in the verses that I just read. What does a great church look like? Look at verse 32. Now the full number of those who believed were of one heart and soul. I would say to you that great unity makes a great church. The Bible says in that verse that the early church had one heart and one soul. They were united in their devotion to their Lord. There was a sense of commonality. They were all heading in the same direction. Aristotle said these words. He said, to have unity is to have one soul in two bodies. Let me say that again. That's a deep thought. To have one's soul, apostrophe S, one's soul in two bodies. When Stacy and I are united, her soul and my soul are one. Her heart and my heart are one. She lives out the calling of my life just as desperately as I live it out. And I live out the calling of her life just as desperately as she lives it out. The early church had a sense of unity to the extent that they were one. They weren't divided. They had a commonality of purpose. They had a commonality of direction. They had a commonality of philosophy. They had a commonality of life. And that all centered around who? Jesus Christ. They were one because they focused their attention on Christ. Now, you say that's hard, but at this time there were approaching 5,000 or 6,000 Christian believers. The church had grown rapidly, so great unity makes a great church. Look in verse 33. And with great power, the apostles were giving their testimony to the resurrection of the Lord. I would submit to you that not only is great unity what brings about a great church, but great power brings about a great church. Friends, I don't know if you know this. I don't have the capacity to change Chris, much less change you. There's not a man on this planet that has the capacity to bring about change in their own life, much less change in the church they pastor. The Bible tells me I can't keep my hair from turning gray. I can't make myself grow an inch. You know, I weighed myself the other day and I realized that I'm not overweight, I'm just too short. I looked at the scale. My problem is not my weight. I just should be 7'4". I have a height problem. But listen, in this church there was great power. But that sense of power was not in argument. It was not in eloquence. What I'm saying is, it wasn't that Peter, James, and John were so educated and so dynamic. It was that the Spirit of God had great access to who Peter, James, and John were. Their availability to the Spirit of God was what brought about the power and change in the life of people. Friends, we are the body of Christ. We have been saved by the grace of God. We have inherited and been given the gift of the Holy Spirit. And collectively, we make up the body of Christ. I want to give you a good thought today. Collectively, we all make one good Jesus. Let me say that again. Collectively, all the Christians in this room, everything that we are together, makes up one good Jesus to the world. Amen. What I'm saying is, you're important. God put Himself in you so that He might live through you and that He might exhibit His great power through you to the world. The promise that was given to Peter, James, and John still exists to us today. Go and make disciples of the entire world. And I'm going to pour out my power on you. And I'm going to be with you when? Until the end of this age. Amen. The promise that was made to Peter, James, and John that the Spirit of God would be with them is still prevalent and a promise to us. And what changes a church and makes a church great is not the eloquence and the power of the people, but it is their dependence upon the power of the Spirit. Amen. You show me a church that is dependent upon the Holy Spirit, and I will show you a church that becomes great. I can't change me, much less you. For those of you who are thinking about getting married, anybody in here thinking about getting married? For those of us who have been married quite some time, we would tell you, if you think you're going to change your spouse when you marry them, think again. They're going to be the same person you married all their life. That's not a reflection of my wife, that's a reflection of me. Listen, it's this thing that in the early church there was a great demonstration of the power of God. Supernatural things were happening as the apostles preached the doctrines of Christ. And what is missing in the church today is not eloquence. What is missing in the church today is not organization. We're not missing money. We're not missing buildings. I will tell you, First Baptist Church, what we are missing. We are missing the demonstration of the power of God. Oh, that God would move in our midst. Oh, that God would do some things in the life of this church that the only explanation to them is God.
Amen.
Oh, that things would happen in such a way in this place that when people looked at us, they would say, that's got to be God. You know the problem with most churches in America today? They can tell you why everything is happening and when everything should happen. It wasn't that way in the first church. They live with an expectancy that if God did not come through, when's the last time you lived your life that way? When's the last time you were so far out in faith, depending on the power and Spirit of God, that if He did not come through, you would not get your answer? You say, preacher, that's all spiritual mumbo jumbo. That's just, no, it's New Testament Christianity. Anybody here taking Henry Blackaby's Experiencing God study? Anybody there? Oh man, it's a great study. If you haven't taken it, I recommend it. In there, Henry Blackman makes this statement. He says, too long has the world seen what the church can do for God. It's time we trust God so the world can see what God can do through the church. Christianity in the first century and in the 21st century is not about a group of people living for God. It is about God living in and through a group of people. Christianity is a group of people like you and me coming to the end of ourselves so that we actually begin to depend upon the God who has indwelt us, so that we become His feet and hands, and His power is distributed and demonstrated in our lives. The world can argue our theology, but they cannot argue the life of Christ. They can argue how we parse a word, but they cannot argue the demonstration of the power of God. There was great power, great unity, but there was great grace. Look in verse 33. And with great power, the apostles were giving their testimony to the resurrection of the Lord, and great grace was upon them all. What is grace? It's the unmerited favor and kindness of God. I read and studied and tried to understand a little bit about what this is saying, but I think it's saying this. God kept pouring out His power and grace and love on the people, and the more they received it, the more kind they were towards each other. Do you know at the heart of gratitude is grace? When the unmerited kindness of God is distributed and placed upon our lives, the natural attitude is gratitude toward the rest of God's people. When I understand how good God has been to me, it becomes easy to be good to everybody else. When I sense the presence of God in my own life and understand how needy I was to be forgiven and how wonderful His kindness has been to me, the natural response is I give that kindness away to others. I can tell you, an ungracious, critical, fault-finding person is not walking in the grace of God. An amen should have went right there. I mean, that let me say that again. A critical, fault-finding, judgmental person is not walking in the grace of God.
Amen.
Y'all still are weak. You know why we want amen there? Because we are so critical, fault-finding, and judgmental of each other. We know that if we actually said amen there, the amen would ring hollow in our own hearts. Because just this past week, we had thoughts of judgment, condemnation, and critical thinking about just about everybody in our lives. If I can say one thing about the church in 2023, it's not the most gracious place to live.
Well, they didn't do it the way I like it. Bless God. I don't like that.
I heard one pastor, and I wouldn't say this now, I don't want you to know. A lady came to this pastor, and she said, I want you to know I don't like the music we sing in church. Right in front of everybody at the back, like at the close of service. This pastor was quick.
I like the music that we sing. You should sing something different.
Well, ma'am, when we start worshiping you, we'll take your advice. But we're not worshiping you, we're worshiping Jesus. Everybody said, I don't like that. The reality is, if we don't watch it, church becomes about us. In this church, it was great because church was about God. Church was about His glory. Church was about His truth. Church was about the fact that He could change people. Church was about the fact that they came together and asked God to demonstrate Himself through them. And great grace abounded among His people. May I be honest and transparent? I can be the most critical of people at times. I shared with the new members class about my son Ethan and I getting in an argument. When was it, son? Friday? Huh? Yeah. And it was me. It wasn't him. I was trying to present to my son that I do know what I'm talking about. Anybody else ever been there in your life? And I did not think my son was listening to me as he should. So right over there, in that house that you lovingly provide for Ethan, Stacy, and I put my son in his place. And he said, "Yes, Father." He said, "Yeah." And he walked back to his room. And I am up front, all to myself, and it's like the Holy Spirit said, "Boy, you really showed your son what it means to be a Christian dad. Thanks for helping him to know how much I love him." And it didn't take me long to realize that the Spirit of God was bringing conviction to my heart. And I asked him to forgive me. I confessed that what I had done was wrong, and I ran to the cross. And I thank God that Christ had paid for my stupidity and my sin.
Amen.
Hallelujah, amen. I like it. One person's listening. And then I walked back to my son's room. And I opened the door. And I looked at him and I said, "Ethan, I love you. Daddy just acted in a very unchristian and unkind way. Would you please forgive me?" And with that big smile on his face, he said, "Daddy, I love you. I forgive you." And I haven't worried about it since Friday. I've lived free. The power of God was demonstrated in my home because I woke up and ate a bowl full of stupid. And God graciously forgave it and restored our fellowship, and we were made one. There was great grace. And it wasn't me giving grace to my son. Was my son giving grace to me. So, a great church has great unity, great power, great grace, and great generosity. Look at verse 34. "There was not a needy person among them, for as many as were owners of land or houses sold them and brought the proceeds of what was sold and laid them at the apostles' feet, and it was distributed each as had need." There was a generous spirit. Now let me say to you, that this wasn't communism. The motivation behind this wasn't that they felt forced by some governmental rule. Love was the motivation. They just thought that Christ was coming back, and they sold their stuff and gave it to the apostles, and it wasn't fear of government control. It was gratitude in their heart. But now some have asked this question, is that what it means to be a Christian giver? Turn to Acts chapter 11, for those of you that had your Bible. I don't think this is descriptive or prescriptive of what we do. I don't think that God demands that children of His sell everything and let some super group called apostles distribute it back. But in Acts chapter 11, verse 29, they're taking up an offering. And in verse 29, "So the disciples determined, everyone according to his ability, to send relief to the brothers living in Judah." If you come to the book of Corinthians, here's what giving should be in the life of a Christian. It should be regular. It should be thoughtful. It should be sacrificial. It should be joyful. We decide each week what we're going to give as the Holy Spirit leads us. It should be regular, it should be thoughtful, it should be sacrificial, and it should be joyful. I've said this before and I say it today. If you give your money with a bad spirit, don't give it at all. Because you're robbing yourself of the blessing. Listen, it's not that I've got to give, it's that I get to give. I get to invest in a kingdom who knows no end. I get to be a part of a kingdom that will last forever. I get to present to God money somehow that He will take and touch the ends of the earth with it. There was great generosity in this church. But it wasn't forced. It wasn't contrived. It was voluntary and with a great sense of joy and expectancy. Just give what you and God decide. She'd be joyful. She'd be joyful. There was great generosity. So great unity, great power, great grace, great generosity, and great people make a great church. Look at verse 36 and 7. Then Joseph, that's Barnabas, sold some land and brought it and gave it to the church. Now next week, we're going to pick up in verse 5, and we're going to find out a little bit about how God sees things. But do you know God lives in people? Ordinary people just like me and you. And as we give Him our lives, He takes everything that He's made us to be, everything that He's given us, and He uses it for His glory. And Barnabas is a specific example of the generosity that was happening in the church. It's like Luke says, I want you to see somebody here. He's a son of encouragement. I want to give you a name to what was happening. He sold a field and he brought the money. It's people. It's people. May I share with you that church would be a great place if everybody could say we were sons and daughters of encouragement. I just want to be a son of encouragement this morning. Amen?
Amen.
This is the day that the Lord has made. I'm going to rejoice and be glad in it. This is a great day.
Amen.
It's an awesome day. God is alive and we're His children. He has saved us and called us to be His family. And He has blessed us more than we can ever imagine. And we get the privilege of letting Him use us in His kingdom. So what would make a great church? What makes a great church? Well, some would say it's size. The more of it, the better. I would present it probably that God's not as much concerned about the quantity as He is the quality. You say, preacher, I don't know about that. Read John chapter 6. I referenced that in the new members class. John chapter 6, 15,000 followed Jesus across the city. 5,000 men plus the women and children. Jesus starts speaking to them. And if you read the entire text, they're about verse 60-something. The Bible says they all leave except for the apostles. And Jesus looks at them and says, would you leave me too? And Peter speaks up and says, Lord, where would we go? We are persuaded that you are the Christ and that you possess the words of life. You know, if a pastor in America today had 15,000 and the next day only 12 showed up, you know what he'd do? He would have a nervous breakdown. Because we judge ourselves by the number of people that sit in the pews. When Christ looks at the heart of the people that sit in the pews.
Amen.
The heart of this congregation is much more important to Jesus than the size of the congregation. Because as I read John chapter 6, Jesus didn't tell the disciples, now go round them back up. We got to, listen, if they don't come back, we're not going to have enough money. We got to pay the bills. If they don't come back, people are going to wonder what's wrong with me. We got to make sure the crowd continues to grow because the size of the crowd dictates how good a Savior I am. We got to make sure that the crowd continues to grow because the size of the crowd dictates how good a preacher I am. We got to make sure that the crowd grows. God's emphasis is not that the crowd grows. God's emphasis is that the people grow.
Amen.
And I promise you this. Any church that has a growing people will have a growing outreach. Well, it's the outreach that matters. We need to have more ministries and we need to have more this and more that. That makes a great church. I would submit to you that it's not the breadth of our ministry, but the depth of our ministry that's most important. You know, churches can get so busy doing everything that they really don't do anything well.
Amen.
People, we can be so busy with so many irons in the fire in our personal life that we can't keep them all hot. May I share with you one of the best days in my life was when I learned the power of the word no. I can remember just as plain as day the first time I had the audacity to tell somebody in the church, no. I lived my life for years thinking that any request that was made to me as a pastor was something that I was obligated to do.
Hey, preacher, I rode by the church 11 o'clock at night. I get a call. Hey, preacher, I rode by the church and the lights is on in the sanctuary. Why don't you go over there and turn it out? Oh, no. Why don't you turn around and go turn it out yourself? Did you actually say that? Did I say that, honey? I said, I'm not being mean. I said, but don't you have a key? Well, yeah. Now, some of y'all were listening to me till right then. You turned me off. That preacher, how dare him? We can be so busy trying to please everybody that we please nobody. May I share with you, Christ sent me here to love every one of you unconditionally. But there's only one person he sent me here to please, and his name is Jesus. Amen. And I'm going to put that shoe on your foot. Christ put you in this church to love everybody, but to please him. And you know what I've learned in the years? If we are singularly loving everybody, we'll wind up being pleasing to him. It is because we love one another that we are called his disciples. So if I live my life seeking to love you, I somehow will wind up being pleasing to God. And if you live your life seeking to love each other, we will somehow wind up being pleasing to God. I'm not saying I don't have responsibilities. I'm not saying that I wouldn't come and turn the lights out. But I am saying this. Some of you simply need to learn how to use the word with respect and love, but no. No. Daddy can have $50? No. It's the programs, it's the music. I would say it's not the style, but it's the substance. Churches get so caught up in its style. Pastors don't wear suits anymore because we sing certain kinds of music because we don't do this and we don't do that. And I would say I understand that, but it's not the style of a church that makes it pleasing to God. It's the substance of the church. It's not how we do it, but it's why we do it that's most important to God. It's not what we do, but it's does what we do match Scripture? I would submit to you as a body of believers today that there are traditional churches in this country that are growing by leaps and bounds. They sing hymns every Sunday. And people are coming to faith. They are very traditional in their orientation. Some are even liturgical. And God is pouring His Spirit out on them. And it's a great church. I would present to you today that there are some contemporary churches. They sing the latest thing on the radio, and they love Jesus with all their heart, and the Word of God is preaching, they're growing by leaps and bounds. I would submit to you that it's not the style of the church that makes it grow, it's the Savior of the church that makes it grow. That's not to say we shouldn't sing diversities of music, that's not to say we shouldn't have diversities of programs, but it is to say that you can have all of that and not be a great church. But I would suffice it to close with this. Any church that Jesus has will be a great church.
Amen.
Because any church that Christ is Lord of, He will make it what He wants it to be. And here's my prayer, guys. My prayer is that in the years ahead, we will all look back and say, this isn't the church Chris wanted it to be. This isn't the church that the deacons wanted it to be. This isn't the church that the young or the old or anybody else wanted it to be. We are living in the church that Christ wants us to be. I pray in the years ahead, we will become a great church that is united, powerful, graceful, generous, and full of great people. I love you with all my heart. I pray for you weekly. I pray that the Word of God will be the guiding force and guiding element of our church, and that it will always be empowered by the Spirit. I close with this. Dr. Warren Wiersbe was a great pastor and preacher and Bible teacher, great author. He tells a story one time of being in a building program at a church he was at. He was pastor of Moody Bible Church. But he was at a church and they were in the middle of a building program. And Dr. Wiersbe said he went to the architect and he told him this. He said, maybe it can just be a simple edifice, but we need to have a more elaborate front to make it look like it's really expensive. Just want it to be simple, but put a good front on it so everybody will ride by and go, man, look at that church. You've done that before, haven't you? Rode by and went, man, what a church. He said the architect came back immediately with these words, absolutely not. The church stands for truth and honesty. And any church I design will not have a facade. And then Dr. Wiersbe said this, the building should tell the truth, not pretend to be what it isn't. Let me say that one more time. The building should tell the truth and not pretend to be what it isn't. You know that's an analogy, don't you? Now close with this. A great church is a church that tells the truth and never pretends to be what it is. A great Christian is a Christian who simply says, this is who I am, this is where I am, and this is what God is doing in me. And they never pretend to be something outwardly that they know they are. May we be a great church because we are serviced by a great people who are willing to be known for who they truly are and not what they want people to think they are. Lord, the early church was a united, powerful, gracious, generous people. And God, I believe that that is represented here in this congregation, not as fully as we hope it to be. But Lord, I have seen in this place a wonderful, united people that love Jesus. Not perfectly yet, but that do. And Lord, I sense your power, not like we want it to be. Lord, pour it out, especially in the days ahead. I sense great grace, a loving, inclusive, kind congregation. Lord, I sense generosity, not where it should be, but thank you, it's growing. Father, the only way we can become a great church is to look to your word and your spirit. And I pray today that we all, starting with Chris Gulledge, we all will. May your word and your spirit empower us. And may someday by your grace in the future, may we be a great church. And I pray this prayer, Father, in Jesus' name. Amen. I give you two thoughts and we're going to go. And yes, I've preached 33 minutes. These are thoughts to ponder. And the invitation is for you to go and ponder these thoughts. And I pray you'll write them down, those that The first thought is this: a great church focuses on unity and generosity. If you read that passage again, go back and look at your notes, you'll see that a great church focuses on unity around the Word of God in Christ and being generous with each other in the community they live in. Second thought to ponder: a united and generous people will never lack for God's power and grace. God is looking for a people ready to receive His power and His grace. God, the eyes of the Lord, search to and fro, looking for a man whose heart is right toward Him, so that God may be strong on their behalf. The eyes of the Lord are looking for a church whose heart is right toward God, so that God then might be strong on their behalf. My prayer is that we will ponder what it really means to be a great church. And then we'll trust God to make us that.
Amen.
Let's stand. Father, thank you for your truth. Thank you for the power of the example of the early church, for what you'd say about them, for how they represent who we should be today. Lord, I thank you for the wonderful fellowship that you're developing here, a group of people who you love, who you care for. And God, I pray that in the days ahead, you will make us, in your eyes, a great people for our Savior. In His name I pray. Ask you to be seated one moment. Brother Mark, who's the moderator of the church, has to come and give you one announcement. And after that, he'll dismiss us.